My role in my own heart and the reason why I was there is that I needed to speak the truth.
I had to educate myself. Personally, I'm pro-vaccination, but having to sack people because they don't take a vaccination is, in my book, just immoral.
Like a river that is flowing, well, you know.
This is the world that we're in now. You better toe the line. But we wouldn't.
No, I need to do this. I feel so strongly about it. But I'm proud of what I did and what I fought for.
The Wellington protest was that light. It gave me that faith back that maybe we don't have to go down that dark road.
This was where our power was. I just wanted to get one night on the whenua, and if we had got through that, I was happy.
If the politicians of New Zealand think that these little games that they're playing against us up against some of the most resourceful people in New Zealand, they're dreaming.
Give them an umbrella!
I think I understood because I listened. Your job as a politician is to represent the people.
This leadership group had a person offered to negotiate. I just assumed the government would behave reasonably.
If democracy is a conversation and politicians don't want to have the conversation, what are we all doing here?
Be calm, everyone. Peace and love.
How can you be an anti-vaxxer when you had a vaccine? You know, like you did it, right? You're not an anti-vaxxer, you're an injured person.
We'd already been bullied out of everything else. I didn't have anything else to lose.
Made me cry every day they didn't come.
Where's your mana?
Welcome to the Daily Examiner. My name is Elliot Lay. That was probably the first time I've watched that particular trailer from start to finish. And I think that perhaps you also, like me, were a little bit poignantly moved and definitely things that we remember. Now, firstly, some housekeeping. Thank you so much for coming in and joining us. As some of you are aware, our accounts have been restricted. So we are in a little bit of a lull on that, but we thank you so much for joining us. As you, if you want, just go share away all over the place as you can, not a problem. We're also going to make sure that this gets put into articles and situations so that we can all watch the episode that we have tonight. So, and as per normal, we love to have you as part of the korero, part of the talanoa, part of the discussion. And if you do want to, just add in something in there and we'll bring it up with our very special guest tonight. And so let's get it on. Let's have a discussion about this. And already, I see you guys already in there. Awesome. Well done. Great to see you. Karen, good to see you there. Chloe, Gail. All right. Great to see all you guys in there. Excellent. So without further ado, I want to bring in my guest so we can get stuck into it. He is a man who's had over 30 years experience, actually. He's a phenomenal worker, one of those really good, strong people. But I wanted to see if we can also prick some of his knowledge as to what's going on. So without further ado, I want to bring to the stage Mr. Jared Connon. Jared, talofa.
Talofa, how are you?
I'm good. How are you? So thank you so much for being here. Jared, could you, first off, but just to set the scene, before we get into our discussion around the powerful thing of why we're here, can you give us a quick bio of yourself and just to help us understand who you are and where you come from?
Sure thing. So, yeah, I can start right at back at the beginning. I was born in West Auckland, moved to the far north. Yeah. Oh, sorry, you're laughing.
Hey, can you get your cars off the lawn, please? Hey.
Yeah, we moved to the far north when I was a teenager and then settled in Whangarei with the family, did my high school years there, And I was privileged enough to be offered an opportunity to join the film industry, actually through a Ngāti Wai access training scheme in Northland. So, I was sent to Auckland to work with the esteemed and revered Don Selwyn, who's no longer with us, at He Taonga Films. So I started my career in Māori television, and it was an absolute privilege to be working with those artists of the time. And I started in the locations department. And for those of you who don't know what that means, it's the section of a film crew who takes care of finding all the houses, beaches, forests, roads to film on where the scenes are set. And you also take care of getting all the permissions. So I deal in permits and liaising with councils, liaising with the communities. So it was very much a job that required a lot of interaction, a lot of dialogue, a lot of understanding, because everybody's got needs. The film production has needs, the community has needs. So you sort of spend your time, as one person described it to me once, the oil and the grit was the job that I was doing. So I really loved that, and had a lot of fun out taking photographs. So that eventually led me into feature films. So, really feature films started for me when I joined the team on Lord of the Rings back in 1999. And, sort of things took a big step up for me in my career at that point. That was a highlight and something I look back on and cherish. And, through all of that, though, there's, I was getting these opportunities because, I believed in what I did. I was passionate about the industry and the arts, and I enjoyed working hard, and I enjoyed the people I worked with. And it was it's always been a lot of fun. Working in the film industry, no 2 days are the same, no matter what anybody tells you. We get to travel the country. It's like bringing together a little family every single time. Sometimes some of the cousins don't quite turn up at the right time, and they come on another project, but the film industry is quite close-knit. We all know each other. We're all connected. And, that's both domestically and internationally. So, I've always, had my fun. We've had a good time doing that. And this all sort of, blew up for me, obviously, and a lot of other people who are joining us here, and for others, across the country when, the mandate started to become a reality for us. And so that led us to where we are today, sitting here talking about this and, the work, that we're about to release, our feature film, River of Freedom, directed by Gaylene Barnes.
So, and as you brought up, right, we had 2020, and I believe it was something like April or so when the first lockdowns occurred. Did that pretty much gut the film industry in New Zealand? Did that stop everything down?
Yeah, everything shut down. We, I remember having conversations before Christmas about it because I was working with an international team on the Rings of Power TV series. And there was they'd started to hear news of it and was sort of starting to wonder what was going on. We all came back to work in the new year, and then, everything started, kicking off. But, when the lockdowns happened, that was, it was pretty devastating for the industry. It was devastating for the country. We were one facet of, the fallout of those lockdowns, which, at the time, I didn't see them as being devastating. I have to say, I was sort of like, I hadn't really looked into it that deeply, to be honest. And that was seemed to be, a somewhat sane answer to what seemed like a pretty standard response to something that was being explained to me by our podium of truth. So I sort of it sort of took me a while to sort of start to question, more fully what was going on, I have to say.
So that's actually okay, great. So now we get into the little party, which I think is a good one to sort of bring into, because I think many people did actually feel that they felt like, well, the rest of the world, this is a horrific bug, something's ripping through every nation, we're all quite fearful, and for valid reasons, or at least what seemed to be valid reasons at the time. What was the turning point for you? What was that part where you started to question and query?
For me, it was really it was around the mandates, to be honest. You know, I'd been watching a lot of the conversation going on, but really, my family and I, personal health, it's very important to us. You know, we don't take it lightly, and the way that the vaccine program was being spoken about, the speed in which it was being delivered, and I have my own understanding and knowledge around vaccines and how they function, and that's just through personal research over the years. So I wasn't really swallowing that little hook, line and sinker thing that they were throwing out there. So that's really when they started talking about there being a vaccine, we were we were skeptical of it, and our position was very much, okay, so there's going to be a vaccine, fine, no problem, but don't worry, they'll never mandate it. You know, Jacinda's said that, I felt confident in that. I felt confident in the country. I honestly was like, no, and I'd said it at home numerous times, they're never going to mandate it. They never will. New Zealanders will not accept that. So when it was announced, that was what really sort of, lit the fire under me. And when I started to see those effects hitting the screen industry, and hearing about people being fired for being unvaccinated, that was what really kind of set me off on the journey that I'm on in regards to sort of, just trying to raise awareness around, how, poorly this situation was held, and that, we're not just some sort of disposable part of society that people can just brush away.
Right. Yes. Okay. So that's when it sort of changed for you. And I think a lot of us actually did. The mandates got worse. Then we started seeing rufflings within the populace, the civilians. You, as you advised, were looking at creating awareness around certain aspects. What were those things that you were trying to create in terms of awareness? And perhaps if there's a segue, is that also when you started to... Well, no, wouldn't have come up then. Wouldn't have come up at that point. So when were things getting a little bit more worrisome? So you've said about when things started to question and turn, and that you weren't taking the whole line, hook and sinker. When did things start to get really worrisome? Because I think that seems to be a bit of a three-phase thing of what I've seen with people in general when I've been interviewing them, is there seems to have been, we know things seemed, or we thought that things meant well, and then it just got a little bit too far. Then there were things where it appeared actually what you're saying on the screen every day at 1 p.m. isn't quite matching up with what appears to be factual or cross-reference. And then in the end, it was a straight up, you are basically taking on our democracy. You're starting to remove constitutional rights and all of those parts. When did things get really worrying for you?
So we, we lived in Wellington at the time, and we spent... once we started to get an inkling that things were not as they seemed, we started attending the rallies, we started attending the protest marches, and I always say, thank you to those people who organized those those events in Wellington, and a lot of that was Freedom and Rights Coalition, they gathered many people in Wellington and got us there and took us all to Parliament. And there are many other groups involved in that as well. But, it was in those moments, and that's when you start to talk to people. You connect with the community. You start to get a better understanding of what's going on. You start to hear more information, and you start to, you start diving deeper into what the situation is around the world, how it's affecting us here in the country. And you could just really see things were just not right when, I was dealing in bringing international people into the country. So I was able to access the MIQ system for, I can't even remember the name of it now, what they called them. Essential workers. We could bring essential workers from offshore to help liven up the screen industry here. So I was accessing that system and starting to see, a little bit behind the curtain, so to speak, and, just going, none of this actually makes sense. And sort of, seeing the way they were reporting the transmission of the virus and all of those scenarios, and it just started, really sort of, just my antenna started firing, and you know, a lot of that, and then it was really you know, once the mandates were announced incrementally across various sectors of the country, that really you know, I started talking to those people who were working in those areas, and you know, telling them how, you know, unsettling it was that they were being mandated and that it was going to be coming for everybody. I didn't realize how strict it was going to be, but it was, you know, it was really, for me, it was about the them taking away my rights, you know, really. Was you know, something I'd never even fathomed in my life. It was never a prospect.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, and it really was. It was
Yeah.
Yeah, and you really do seem to be saying what a lot of us have felt, which is, I don't think any of us really truly believed that we would see the removal of so many democratic principles, basic democratic principles. And I think that was quite extraordinary. Okay. You know what? I'm going to ask this. It's not something that I generally ask, but I will ask this. This is
Go for it.
I have a thought about, I think I subscribe to, and I'm not sure, I can't remember the person's name, but he was a Belgium scientist, and he was looking at mass formation psychosis. And of course, the very insidiously or scarily, the idea is similar to the German populace of the 1930s Germany, and how they were able to be crafted or manipulated, made malleable by certain aspects going on, and so they were able to sort of turn a blind eye, because of course we saw a lot of people being utilized by politicians and media to somehow look upon the unvaccinated, and it became this real word heavy, very Marxist, I would say, very worrisome style of methodology of communication by various state-funded groups. Yeah. Where those who are unvaccinated were seen as not really human, as in they are others who are being obstructions between us and freedom and life. And is that something that you saw in terms of your own goings in that time?
Yeah, very much so. And like I said, we connected with people at the protests, and that was where that level of information started being shared with me. And you know, I was certainly, you know, came across Matthias Desmet, who he was mentioning from Belgium, you know, in his early works and words, and they were all very powerful. And the thing is that when you hear them, they make sense. You start to understand what's going on, and you start to, the pieces of the puzzle start connecting, and you're sort of going, yeah, this is what's going on. This, you know, and you know, it was unsettling. And I think that was, you know, once I realized for myself that I wasn't going to be able to, you know, continue working, literally I wasn't able to go to work anymore. I realized I wasn't going to be able to set up a film production. So therefore I was on the out. There was no way I was going to ever put together a job that required anybody to be vaccinated. You know, I didn't, you know, if it meant we had to do testing, we'd have to do testing. At that point I was like, okay, this is a way through it for everybody. We can test, and therefore the unvaccinated can come to work and we can all be together. And the messaging from the government was just so, it just refused to allow any conversation. You know, the legislation was written to refuse it. You know, you start to understand how things like the nudge unit in the UK work, and they just sort of, you know, it becomes all about the advertising, all about the propaganda, all about the media, and the people do not want to question it, they just want to go along with it. And I say I was always complicit in that myself. I always lived a life of going, I'm just happy paying my taxes and going to work every day, everybody. You know, I was a little, you know, you're a rat on the wheel, you're keeping the machine going, you're doing your part in society. And but then you see, then you sort of, you know, I stepped off the wheel for a moment and then went, hang on, what? I wasn't going anywhere. I was literally just, you know, and these things start, you know, dawning on you as to the society that you live in. And then this is when the conversation becomes the global conversation. I used to always joke around and say, yeah, you know, there's no such thing as this, you know, these global conspiracies, because our local politicians couldn't organize a piss up in a pub, let alone engage with a foreign nation towards an ultimate goal, and going, this is just not possible. And then you know, once those layers are peeled back, you start to see it and you go, oh my God, excuse my language. Oh my gosh, they've been doing it the whole time. They've been doing it the whole time to us. The, you know, it's been going on and it's just sort of, you know, blindly, you know, following their lead, you know, the cheese has been dragged in front of us the whole time. And, you know, I was quite shocked as to how the structures of society were working. And I met so many people who have been, who said to me, we've been fighting this for a long time. We've been awake for a long time. And I sort of, you know, I feel, you know, myself like, oh boy, I wish I was awake a lot sooner.
It's hard though, isn't it? Yeah.
It's hard. And, you know, it's been one of the most, you know, liberating things that's happened to me in my life. You know, I've met some of the most amazing people because of this movement, because of waking up and really realizing who your true friends are and also who the true community is. And, you know, and our job is to resist. Our job is to push back. Our job is to stand up for everybody and not just, you know, do what the state demands, because the state is not working in our interests. They have, you know, I've got no problem with there being a government that looks after the things the people want, but they do so many things that the people do not want. They do not listen to us. It's, I don't have an answer to this. You know, the political system is a, you know, is not, is no longer functioning, in my opinion. But you know, it's a much bigger conversation. The, you know, we sort of all lean into the idea, you know, of the global, you know, control that's happening here, and we see our country being, you know, forced into alliances and allegiances and pacts that, you know, a lot of people don't agree with. You know, and I see it affecting everybody around us. You know, the harms of the vaccine are just the most heartbreaking, you know, result of that. But seeing people lose their livelihood, you know, the way the country's being run is just, you know, demoralizing at times. And, you know, we moved away from Wellington in the end. We moved up to the Manawatu, you know, and we're in the heart of the dairy country now, and we see them struggling.
Oh, nice.
And, you know, they're being affected by it, you know, but nobody talks about that either. And you're going, you know, just everywhere, everybody is in, everybody is very, you know, there's a lot of anxiety out there in the community, I think, because nobody can see where this is going. There's no direction, you know, at the head of the country. It doesn't seem like there's a way of fixing it, which is demoralizing for people. And, you know, we've got to, you know, we've got to find the, you know, the light in all of that. We've got to, you know, just, you know, link arms, stay strong. You know, it's exactly like at the protest, you know, there's dark times ahead, but, you know, if we stand strong together, we'll get through this. And, you know, just find the joy in each and every day and be present. You know, you just got to sort of go, you know, I'm happy, I'm alive and healthy. And, you know, I've got a family that loves me, you know, and I've got, you know, people around me who I trust and respect. So, you know, I'm pretty blessed at the end of the day, Elliot, to be honest.
Awesome. That's beautiful. All right. So then that's a nice way of getting into the, well, the storytelling, the pain and struggles, and you're absolutely right. We saw suicides. We saw homes going under. We saw absolute tragedies going on all over the place. We saw families being broken. We've got an entire generation of kids now who are actually educationally backed a little bit because they had so many problems. I've talked to multiple principals around the country, and they all say that they've had many problems with their new entrants and their first and second years because of that social disruption, the heavy duty. Okay, let's get into the ideas around your storytelling. How did you get to be a part of the team with Gaylen and with the storytelling side of it? Can you, because now we're getting into the beautiful nitty gritty stuff. So can you tell us, take us through that part?
Well, I blame my one of my best friends, Julian Arahanga, for this. So, Julian, or Sonny, he's my producing partner on River of Freedom. You know, we've known each other for many, many years, and he's sort of, you know, very well known for his role as playing Nig in Once Were Warriors. He's a producer and a director, you know, an amazing creative. And yeah, we've worked together on a number of projects, but we found out that we were, you know, very much aligned in our views on what was going on here. So we were attending a few protest marches together, and Julian was recording, you know, interviews. So he said he was looking to do a documentary about what was going on. And so when the convoy arrived in Wellington, we were all down there on the first day, and Julian was there, and he was just sort of, you know, he's getting all, you know, fired up and, you know, running around shooting interviews. And we were just there for the protest, you know, supporting everybody. You know, we were so proud of what everybody had done, and, you know, arrived on our doorstep in Wellington, which was very convenient for me, thankfully, because I just lived around the corner. I didn't have to tent it, but, you know, I was so, you know, so proud of everybody who did. But we had many, many friends from around the country who arrived, who just started flooding into the city. So we became a bit of a hub. You know, people would cut, they'd land at our house, then they'd go down to the protest, they'd leave all their things.
Nice.
We had an open door policy, so we'd take people back from the protest, we'd let them shower, hang out for the day, just recharge, just get out of the noise a little bit. So we had so many people coming through the house, and even my kids some days would come downstairs and go, be like, oh, who are you? And they'll be like, oh, just from the protest. And I'd go, okay, another one. But the kids were at the protest and loved it. Like, it was, they just said they had the best time. You know, it was everything that we say it is and that the, you know, mainstream media and everybody denies, but the kids felt safe. They were fed. They were looked after. They were in an environment, they were in a caring environment that, where they didn't feel threatened at all at any stage. So it was, you know, it was that dynamic. But anyway, I digress. So Sonny was there, and then he said, you know, I bumped into these young guys. You know, they're a little crew who do this social media stuff, the Manaki Media, you know, good friends, Dane, Geordie, and Briar. And he said that they're shooting some really cool stuff. So I reckon we should hook up. There's heaps of camera people here, and we should all get together and we should start making a documentary properly. And I was like, okay. I said, cool, let's get into it. And then I think the next day somebody said, yeah, there's these guys. Gaylene Barnes, she's a director from Christchurch, and she's coming up with the convoy from Invercargill, and she's got a DOP from Auckland, Mark Lapwood, and he's coming down from the Cape, and they're going to be with us in a few days. And so I was like, oh, okay, so this is kind of getting real now. So we sort of, it all sort of came together very organically, but it's just, we were just connecting with our community, our film community were there, and it was just like fantastic. So we turned around, we said, look, okay, let's try and figure out how we can do this. So, you know, we reached out a little bit further, you know, we sort of, you know, formulated a bit of a plan, a bit of a strategy as to how we're going to shoot things and how we're going to, you know, keep hold of the data every day and how we're going to, you know, hand it off to, you know, my great friend Greg Daniels. He was doing our post work for us and, you know, working in editorial. And so there became a real, you know, hive of people, you know, starting to work on this project. And, you know, then more technicians would start reaching out to us, and we had our sound recorders, Ben Vanderpoel from Auckland, and he was like, I'm coming to the protest and I just need to plug my pocket. So we had him and we had so many fantastic people. We had Heidi, we had Jackie, we had, who else was there with us? Helen was there. It was just, you know, it became our little family. Yeah, we became a little hapu unit there as well. We then took a trailer into the protest and we set ourselves up a production center. So we sort of, you know, we had our own little generator there, and then we put a little power board outside that everybody could come in and charge their phones on. And, you know, and we became a little bit of a known as a media center, even though we're just shooting our thing. So, but, you know, it was, you know, thanks to, you know, Gaylene was tireless going out there every day. The Manaki Media crew were tireless out there every day. Our shooters were just like, they never stopped. Mark was just had his drone out. He was shooting things and just getting those interviews, you know, were just, you know, invaluable because they were absolutely of the moment, you know, and everything we captured, we didn't know how it was going to be built or how the story was going to unfold, because you've just got to document it at the time as it happens. And, you know, we were, because we had so many cameras, because we had so many opportunities, that's where the richness of this film has come from. We always had a vision and we stuck to it. And I'll say this now, which is, it's really, really important to the film that we've put together, is we needed to make sure that we delivered a film that could be put into theatres. So we were producing a film that the exhibitors, the owners of cinemas, would feel comfortable playing in a theatre, that it was of a level that they could understand, you know, for want of a better term, because we needed to access the standard, you know, distribution models of getting a film into theatres to break down those barriers, where we often spend a lot of our time in the internet, you know, seeing our information, sharing that, and it becomes, you know, we're tied into it ourselves and our community. But we needed to use this film to get the word out to the broader community, to our friends and our family who don't want to sit at a computer with us and watch, you know, all the crazy things that we see. And we see a lot of crazy things. You know, I know it, you know, we all know it. There's some, yeah, there's some wackadoodle things that go on in the internet.
A few holes.
Yeah, but the great thing is it's the level of information that can be shared on the internet is what is so powerful and so potent about that tool. But the, you know, we wanted this film to be an opportunity for people who wanted to know what was going, who are curious about the protest or curious about what's being said, you know, from, you know, our perspective. And this is an opportunity for them to sort of, you know, have access to that information without feeling threatened or feeling like they've got to make a decision about, you know, which side they sit on. So a really powerful message that came to us as we were editing the film was we had, you know, Annie Collins come in and take a look at the cut. Now, Annie Collins is a film editor in the New Zealand film industry of high regard, probably our most highly regarded, well, you know, esteemed, you know, editors. She edited the protest film Patu back in the 80s for Merita Mita. So she knows protest films, and she sits at the top of many, many institutions and guilds, and she's a tutor. So we asked her to come in and take a look at it for us and give us an opinion on where we were at, and, you know, just to help steer us. So, and, you know, she is not on our team. You know, so it was quite, we all felt quite vulnerable at that point, because she was the first person outside of our community who had seen the material. So we thought, well, this could either go really bad or really good, but, you know, it's a good chance. We've got to put ourselves through the, through the meat grinder on this one. So Annie came in, and it was really long at that point. You know, we always knew it was, you know, we had 5 hours of a film that we needed to, you know, get down to, you know, something more digestible. So, but Annie, you know, she soldiered on through it with us, and you know, we sat down afterwards, and it was probably, I think, you know, some crazy time like midnight or, you know, but she said, look, you know, I was definitely, you know, not supportive of the protests. I live in Wellington, and there were just all these annoying people everywhere, and they were blocking the roads, and I couldn't get to university to do my class, my tutoring, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so I was going, but now I've seen your documentary, I have questions, and I am on the fence. And she said, I wasn't expecting that. And it was just like, wow, oh, wow, okay, so it works. We're onto something.
That's so, a win.
Yeah, it was really encouraging, you know, for Gaylene, who had been editing the film, you know, just relentlessly. You know, she was working, you know, with a great team of editors. You know, we had Ben Peldrell there, you know, playing a strong support role. But you know, we knew we still needed to do more work to get it into a format that cinemas would accept. So there was a, you know, we were revitalized at that point. And look, it took us, you know, longer than we expected, but it took as long as it needed, because there was so much more, you know, so much more story to tell. Once we put the first edit together, you know, Gaylene realized we needed, you know, I'm sure she always knew that we needed more interviews. So we went back to some of those people who, you know, were, you know, integral to the protest movement, to get them to speak about their story, about what happened to them, about what their experiences were, what their, you know, how they saw the situation unfold. So very much the same as me talking about it now, we got other people to engage in that. And there are some very powerful testimonies there. You know, a lot of people who are hurt, but are also looking for, you know, the opportunity to find a way to make a better country, you know, to find a better community, to find a better world at the end of the day. And, you know, the film really is, it's, you know, it's very, very powerful. There is no doubt about that. It still, you know, moves me every time I watch it, without a doubt. The content and the people's stories is just what's so engaging. And, you know, you really do feel, you know, the first part of the film is getting everybody's stories as they're on the convoy leading to Wellington. And so by the time the audience gets to Wellington to the protest, I'm sure everybody in the audience will just feel like, right, let's do this all again. It's a very potent tool, marketing, and it's a very potent tool, the power of the image. And as you say, it's right, you know, full circle back to what you said about the way the government use it. We're not here to, you know, try and, you know, force a message down people's throat. We just want people to hear the story. And that was what we said at Parliament as well. We just want to be heard.
Absolutely. And, you know, you're right. You such powerful imagery. And I mean, when I think about it, I mean, this makes the story makes such a powerful story. You know, this is one of those stories that should be used even in history classes, but this is one of those really epic sort of stories. I mean, you had a government who has been found to have engaged in deception, they have engaged in actual propaganda, that they have not just, that they've been funding things like the disinformation project, that you had people saying that they were white supremacists and they were Islamophobic people, that they were racists. They were throwing out every type of negative epithet that they could find at those who were simply protesting for their rights and their ability to even speak on the issue, and to even have someone in Parliament actually stand up and try to be a voice in force of that, to be a representative. I think it's a very fascinating dynamic, you know, historically speaking. This needs to be studied for in the future for a long time as to how things go wrong. But you're absolutely right. Now, there has been a question come up, but I'm going to wait for that question. There has been some wonderful comments that we've seen. Mia, it's so powerful. Tissues needed. Awesome. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Look at that. Yep. And then you've got Karen there. Think aside, ideal. Rest don't care. You've got Liao crying with the trailers. Absolutely. This one, Liu has actually got a very poignant part here. I still feel triggered by a police uniform. I have to say that I've actually lived a lot of my life now. In parts of my life, I've been a drug dealer. I've been a real scumbag. But overall, I've always had a great deal of affection and respect for our police. Great deal of respect and affection. I can't believe it, but the protest for me actually broke that. I don't trust them, and I hate that. And the word is hate. I hate that I feel that I just cannot trust them anymore. And, you know, so there's the splitting of families. I think there's a lot of brokenness that has been in here. And I think that a story like this, it can actually not just speak the truth as to what happened beyond the narratives by media, mainstream media, but in actual fact, I think this could actually be a healing or the start of a healing process, because I think that's desperately needed in all this. There's a lot of bitterness, there's a lot of anger, and there's a lot of memes coming out even showing things like that.
Yeah, I went to a industry meeting recently, the first one I'd been to since the mandates, and I was able to speak to a few sort of, respected industry leaders there, and it just all welled up in me where I was speaking to them. I said, look, I've got to say to you, you know, I'm still very hurt and I'm still really angry about what happened in the mandates here in the screen industry ourselves, just because I was so disenfranchised from my career. I literally had to walk away from my career. That's what happened when the mandates rolled in. I rung the Film Commission, I rung the Screen Technicians Guild, I tried to speak at this, you know, the Producers Guild meetings to try and express this, loss. And I was grieving myself for my career and what I believed was, you know, my life that was being taken away from me. That's how strongly I felt about it. I've since found that that was not who I really was anyway. And, you know, I've found that, you know, the strength of myself, you know, thanks to the support of the people around me, to go, no, this is who I am really. And even at the protest, you know, down there one night, I had the epiphany speaking with Carlene. You know, we're just sitting there, we're just talking through, you know, just you know, chitter chatter. And then I was looking up at Parliament and I sort of realized, I got to that point and said, sorry, I just don't remember ever giving you control over me. It was just like, this, you know, okay, so there was this, a thing we understand is called the social contract. You know, but you've broken that. You've literally broken the social contract. You've told me I'm no longer valid. I'm no longer able to participate in the society that you're the head of. So I looked up there and I went, actually, and I just went right back to birth. And I went, when I was born, I was free. And that's where I am now. And I it was a really powerful moment for me personally. And just coming to terms with that. And a lot of people already had understood that freedom within themselves. But, in, you know, it was a, you know, something that really sort of set me on a path to sort of, you know, make sure that I always tried to stand for what I believed in, and, you know, and my opinions are not always the right opinions. They're just my opinions, as is everybody's opinions. And the truth is the truth, and we all have a different way of interpreting the truth, and the way I interpret it is different to somebody else. But that's what you found at the protest. That was the beauty in it, and that is actually what we are. That is what we should all be about in humanity. It's like everybody has their own truth, you know, back to the basic rules, do no harm, and then we can all go on from there, because the diversity and the richness of society is what we all need to make sure we all have a great time on this earth together, you know, and beyond. And you just go, why are you shutting us all down? Why? This is just insanity. We need this. We need people to challenge things. It's like tomorrow somebody will be challenging something that I believe in, and you know what? They can. Yes, that's their right. You know, it's not that I don't want somebody in, you know, running the country, or you know, things need to happen. We need to function. You know, there's logistics and operations, but don't tell me how to live my life. You know, it's like, you know, the law is the law. I get it, but at the same time, don't just create these crazy, you know, restrictions because you've got an idea that this is going to do something. So, oh, still fires me up. I just wanted to acknowledge Liao briefly as well, because it's sort of, you know, I saw her comment come in there, and you know, she's in our trailer and she's been an amazing supporter for us, you know, and the team at the Daily Examiner. The you know, Liao was the, you know, what she did at Parliament was amazing, and it's in our film. You know, she was the person, the only reporter who got the Russell Coutts interview. You know, and that is in the film. You know, she's got a great, you know, her conversation in the film is fantastic. And we just want to send our love to Liao and to, you know, everything that the Daily Examiner does for us.
Yeah, she's quite pushy. awesome. Look, we was. hey, Liao, that's what he told me. He just texted me to say that. See. All right. So we've got a good technical question. This is coming from Josh on YouTube. He's asking, let's get into the movie side of it. How wide is the distribution? How many cinemas do you have nationwide?
Okay. Well, yeah. Great question. Thanks, Josh. You know, get into the old the movie chitter chatter now. So we are. What we're doing is we've started with these premiere events, you know, that they've been announced. We've got Auckland, Christchurch and Wellington. So the first screening is in Auckland at the Civic Theatre, Tuesday, September the 5th, 7 p.m. So our tickets are going on sale for that tomorrow morning. So everybody listening here, go to Ticketmaster tomorrow morning to get your, you know, if you're in Auckland or even the far north, you know, the wider region across the country, come to Auckland, because that's where things are kicking off for us. We then travel to Christchurch. We have our Christchurch premiere at Hoyts Riccarton. You know, tickets are for sale through our website. We have a screenings page. So if you go to our website, which is riveroffreedom.nz, there's a link on there. Click on screenings, and that'll take you straight through to the ticketing page. You can buy tickets now for Christchurch, and you can also go to the Wellington event, which is on Thursday, the 7th of September. And again, tickets are available through Event Finder there. But yeah, that's the first screening of it. So we have gone out and done that ourselves. So they're all private events. We've booked them ourselves. We've, you know, we've had to, you know, stump up the cash to book the venues, but we've had great conversations with the venues, you know, very encouraging to be back, you know, and engaging in the community and sort of saying, look, this is our film. This is what we're about. And they're all fine. They're all like, just like, fantastic. No problem. You're going to sell out our theatre? Do it. You know, and so what happens after that for us is we've only managed to secure 10 screens across the country, but that is 10 more than we could have ever hoped for. So we're very happy with that. You know, we have 10, you know, 10 amazing theatre owners who want to show our film to their communities. They know they've got an audience out there. You know, we know there's a lot of, you know, theatre owners that, you know, are shying away from it because they don't want to court any controversy. Some of them just completely just don't want a bar of us, and then they've told us that much. But that's fine, you know. I not here to change people's minds in that way. But what I, you know, what I believe will happen is that once people start to see how quickly we sell out these premiere events, and then what the community responses at the theatres that are showing it, more theatres will ask to show it. But it's up to everybody who's listening to continue to spread the word. But the most powerful thing they can do is actually reach out to their local theatre and let them know they'd love to see it. Are they screening the documentary River of Freedom about the Wellington protest? Just ask them. Better to do it in email, because then the email is going to be handled. You know, a phone call sometimes just goes to a voicemail or a, you know, an office worker. Oh, yeah, I'll let them know, da-da-da. But, you know, send an email and just let them know that there's an audience in their community that wants to watch it. So we will be posting the cinemas on our website just, you know, yeah, in the next week or two, I'd say. We're just sort of, you know, working out the finer details of all of that. You know, who's showing it and where they're showing it and what those are, because we want to, you know, promote, you know, we promote all the theatres and give them thumbs up for, you know, putting the film out there. And you know, we haven't cracked the Auckland market yet, but we're pretty close. We think we've got a big theatre that wants to show it, and so, you know, there's going to be a lot of announcements in the actual screening of it. And then I think we'd probably, depending on how it runs in theatres, sort of dictates what we do with it when we release it online. So you know, we're, you know, I don't have anything to say how that online is going to be delivered to people, but you know, again, subscribe to our website and all the information, as soon as we announce something, the notice will come out to you as a subscriber, and we'll keep updated, and all the you know, the usual. We've got the Telegram channel, we've got the Instagram, you know, social media websites. You can follow us on YouTube. So just sort of, you know, we just keep pushing it out there. You know, the next thing that we're planning is we're getting our international cut ready. You know, so
awesome.
Yeah, so we've our executive producer from the UK, Robin Minotti Graziadi. He came on board with us and facilitated getting Eric Clapton's music for us. So you know, so Robin's going to sort of, you know, get involved in, you know, helping us get the film out internationally. Again, it's probably just going to be online, but you never know. There could be a film festival that wants to play it, you know, once they see, you know, how successful it is, and, you know, that we can share it with them. So, you know, we will need to reduce it. I mean, a lot of the film really speaks to the New Zealand story. So a lot of it's very local. So a lot of people overseas, you know, they don't, there's things in there that just won't make sense to them. But, even our EP, you know, Robin, he watched it recently again, and he was just like, he said he was just so moved by the story of the, you know, of the, you know, tangata whenua, you know, Māori, everybody who was there, and that relationship to the land that really comes across. You know, there's a lot of that story in the film, and you know, that's, you know, something that he said international audiences are just really intrigued by. You know, what that means for the people of New Zealand. You know, the politics of it all, the cultural history, and that which gets talked about as well. You know, these things have happened in our past, and here we are again, you know, having to go through these motions and stand up for ourselves. You know, we're a different world, we're a different society, but, you know, they still want control and we still won't give it to them.
Absolutely. Well, they do. I mean, now, oh gosh, you start talking about politics in a bit, but
so, yeah, that's the side of things. So, you know, we're it's, you know, we're hoping it'll get a broader distribution. The other thing that is happening, sorry, I should mention, that people can arrange their own community screenings as well. So we haven't quite managed to get ourselves set up with a portal for people to make those requests, but people are emailing us and saying, I know it's not being played in my local area. Is there a way that I can set up a screening? And we're like, yeah, sure, cool, it's great. Here's the methodology, da, da, da. And we'll just give them a few instructions. And but, you know, we're still working through all that. But that is another thing where people will be able to set up a screening for themselves, you know, for friends. They can, you know, sell their tickets, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, and there's people are hiring theatres. They're doing it in community halls. I know people have got small private cinemas that are just going to play it endlessly day after day after day.
Awesome. Josh has come up with another question, and yeah, fair enough. So, you know, feel free to be discreet with it or not. He's come up with this one here. How was the movie funded?
Oh, no, we're very transparent about that. So the movie's been funded as wholly crowdfunded. So we...
awesome.
We've had no, there's been no public money. It's all from within, you know, the people of New Zealand and internationally. People have put money into it. So the every time we would release a clip, we would just let people know. We put out a budget. We said this is how much money we're trying to collect. This is what helps us finish the film. We've been so blessed by everybody's donations, unbelievable donations. You know, my mind boggles at times that some of the people have come forward and put the money into us, and you know, and every single donation is, you know, is amazing. You know, so we really appreciate the support of the people, and that's it. There's no other, you know, no other way. And our method, and you know, we haven't sort of formalized this amongst ourselves, but the donations that we receive, we would like, if we ever got to the point of making money back, which is in the film business is highly unlikely. But if we ever made the money back, that money that we collected as donations, we would turn back into donations into the freedom movement some other way. You know, it might be whether it's another film or another opportunity that's happening, but we would never take that money as our profit. That money has been gifted to us to make this film, and if the film ever made a profit, that we would put it all back out there, back into, you know, there's so many great causes out there that we're all involved in that we would not want to see supported, you know, by the fact that we've made this movie, you know, if it got to that level of success.
Oh, awesome. Look, we've pretty much come to the end of it, and it's really good, and I'll be honest,
I've got lots more to say. Come on.
Hey. I'm getting vibes. I feel like it was secondary, but I get vibes like Sound of Freedom, because Sound of Freedom is another movie which was quite suppressed for a while there, and it's actually the people who've all gathered around and they've really funded it, and it's attaching to people at every level, and so they're really highly desiring. I'll be honest, I can't wait to see. I'm gonna be clicking refresh on my screen even while I'm at work, waiting for those tickets to come through so I can zap it in.
Do that.
One thing I'd like to, what I want to give you, Jared, is I want to give you this time just to, what is your last message to the people of New Zealand, to our audience out there, to those who will watch this now and later? Is there any last final message that you would like to give to the people out there? And I'll give you that to speak on.
The thing that you know, I found the most powerful through all of this is the connection, right? The people. There's just like I've never felt that connection before, you know, in all of my life, no matter where I've been or what I've done. You know, you get close to it in a film when you're making a film. You know, you really live very closely with each other. You're all focused on one goal. And it's the creation of a film to be delivered, you know, and then you all break apart and then you come back together again. But what I found through the, you know, through all of this is that connection, we're not breaking apart. You know, we've all come together and we are continuing to move together. And, you know, interestingly, when I first stood up, I put out word to the screen industry to say, I'm writing these letters, open letters to the government, to the film commission, to our guild leaders, saying how, you know, how abhorrent this whole situation is and that nobody will listen to us, that, you know, good people are being tossed out of their work. You know, this is completely wrong. You need to stop and just like listen to us for a moment, you know. And the people that came forward, you know, interestingly enough, the biggest group of people that came forward within the screen industry was the stunt department. You know, why? Because they know that their body is their tool, and there was no way they were going to go down this path and take that risk. And, you know, their ruin their lives, you know, on the basis of something that they could see wasn't really, you know, everything that they've been told on the mainstream. But you know, to sum that up, one of the stunt performers sent me a message, and I still continue to sign off with it, you know, to this day. When people email me, and you know, you get a little bit passionate about what you're writing back to them and sharing the love and the connection of it all, and it's literally like one love stands strong. You know, that's always, that really resonated with me when that one of those stunt performers wrote that to me, and I was like, no, that's exactly it. That's where we should be. That's just, you know, you know, be strong in yourselves, be strong together, and just do everything with love. And then, you know, everybody's got ego, everybody's got, you know, their things they've got to sort out in their life. But as long as you stay true to those, you know, those couple of words, then you'll get through things. You may not get through things yourself, but people will be there for you. And that's, you know, that's kind of the, you know, what I've, you know, just been so moved by, you know, in making this film with the people who've made this film with us, the people we've interviewed, the journey we've all been on together. You know, and I said, I don't know what's going to fill my life after I've finished this film. I'm going to have a big gap. it's all consuming, you know, when you're, you know, when you're doing something like this. But, you know, but it's, you know, I know, you know, I'm going to turn my attention back to sort of, you know, trying to make sure this doesn't happen again in our industry, at least. And I can only do that, you know, as best I can. You know, and with the people around me that you know I've found along the way, and it's been an absolute privilege from the get go. Mm-hmm. You know, every single time, you know, I would meet people, and you know, in various forms, you know, they've all informed me, they've all helped me be who I am today. You know, and I hope that I've given them something back, and I hope the film, you know, is something that they can use to connect with people who have, you know, who haven't let them have the opportunity to share their full story. It's, you know, there's a in the film, it's a story that people can't ignore. You know, if you ignore it, you're basically, there's no hope for those people. You know, really, they're the 30% that are never going to change their mind. They just do not want to believe that any of this was anything more than just a, you know, a blip in the history of, you know, humanity. And it's like, no, it's much bigger than that. I think I once described it to somebody as, you know, it's an attack on our spirituality. You know, I truly believe that from the you know, from the state, and that's the thing that scared them the most, is that the spirituality of the people came together and connected and was not going to accept, you know, what they were doing. So they've always been afraid of that. And something that they can't control. So it's always been an eternal battle, you know, really. And it's not over.
It's not over. Awesome. Jared, thank you so much for being on the show. Thank you so much for sharing your wisdom and your passion and your love with all of us here. I just want to thank you so much and honor you. Mana kia koe. Very much so. So, look, thank you so much. God bless you. And just for all of you out there, thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for persevering. And it's just been, there's been gold nuggets all over the place. So we also say thank you to you. Get onto those lists. All right, be there. I want to see you all. We're going to fill up every single cinema, and let's fill up more than that as well. Let's get our family, our inga, our whānau, all over to those places. I think it's really important, not just to see reminisce, but also to seek that for a better legacy for tomorrow. So God bless every single one of you, and God bless New Zealand. We'll see you again real soon. God bless.
Thanks, Elliot.
My role in my own heart and the reason why I was there is that I needed to speak the truth.
I had to educate myself. Personally, I'm pro-vaccination, but having to sack people because they don't take a vaccination is, in my book, just immoral.
Like a river that is flowing, well, you know.
This is the world that we're in now. You better toe the line, but we wouldn't.
No, I need to do this. I feel so strongly about it. But I'm proud of what I did and what I fought for.
The Wellington protest was that light. It gave me that faith back that maybe we don't have to go down that dark road.
This was where our power was. I just wanted to get one night on the whenua, and if we had got through that, I was happy.
If the politicians of New Zealand think that these little games that they're playing against us up against some of the most resourceful people in New Zealand, they're dreaming.
Give them an umbrella!
I think I understood, because I listen. Your job as a politician is to represent the people.
This leadership group had a person offered to negotiate. I just assumed the government would behave reasonably.
If democracy is a conversation and politicians don't want to have the conversation, what are we all doing here?
Be calm, everyone. Peace and love.
How can you be an anti-vaxxer when you had a vaccine? You know, like you did it, right? You're not an anti-vaxxer, you're an injured person.
We'd already been bullied out of everything else. I didn't have anything else to lose.
Made me cry every day they didn't come.
Where's your money?